Praise the Lord, for he's bringing to me praise, Psalms 48 and 1. I want to welcome you tonight to the site of Sanctuary at St. Paul Missionary Baptist Church here in the beautiful city of Darien Beach, Florida. And welcome tonight to our live Bible study where we have worship and we have word. So tune in, your retreat tonight, for God does love justice. Those who follow his justice has a prosperous life. Amen. Are you ready? Are you ready to worship with us? Well, we're ready to worship with you. Amen. There's a storm out on the ocean, and it's moving this away. If your soul's not anchored to Jesus, you will surely
Thank you. each and every one that is hearing thy voice, O Heavenly Father. Continue to show your blessing on each and every one. And O Heavenly Father, bless our church. Be good through this worship service tonight. Be the God our pastor. Be the God of the young man. Be the God of the family and us. O Heavenly Father, that we may go out from these four walls and do your will, not our will, but thy will be done. O Heavenly Father, just continue to show your love on each and every one. Bless our church and be a light in this community that will draw others to thee. Bring your honor, praise, and glory. And what we have about, we just want to say thank you for everything.
Thank you, Lord. God,
may we continue to do our lives. Before I continue on, we have about, thank you, Lord Jesus, for dying on the cross of our sins, the sins of the world. Continue to show your blessing on each and every one. And forgive us our sins and our shortcomings. And oh, heaven of God, we need to guide us to thee. And oh, bless our families, oh, heaven Father. Bless those who sit among us, wherever they might be. Oh, heaven of God, continue to show your blessing on each and every one. Bless our pastor tonight as he delivers his words to us, O Heavenly Father, from your holy word, and we may apply it in our everyday life to bring you honor, praise, and glory. And O Heavenly Father, bless those who sit among us wherever it may be. And O Heavenly Father, bless our country. O Heavenly Father, there's a panic going on. O Heavenly Father, we know that you are in charge, but the world is yours and the world is thereof. Continue to show your blessing on each and every one, and you know how to stop this virus. And all the other sickness and illness that's going on in our land. And all we have about, we know it can be done according to your will and your purpose. All we have to do is believe in you. And put our hope and trust and faith in you. And bring you honor, praise, and glory. Then you will hear all that. All we have about, just continue to share your blessing on each and every one. All the blessed ways, that's Son Jesus. Amen.
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 Oh, praise the Lord. Thank you, Deacon Leroy Harrison. Come on, let's give God some praise. Nothing like the prayer. Amen. Listen, we're getting ready to go into another part of our worship, but we worship in song. Join in with us. Our praise team is coming. And then once they're finished, do me a favor, get your Bible up and get your Sunday school lesson. Again, get your Bible and get your Sunday school lesson. And I want you to join in with us on today. Our lesson for this evening is a just loving God. Oh, what a great joy to know that he's not just loving, but he's just. Come on, put your hands together for our praise. encouraging word, amen, from us to you, those of you that are sitting here in the sanctuary, and for those of you that are watching us by the various methods of our social media and technology, we want you to know that that's what we believe here at this historical St. Paul Baptist Church, and that the Lord is mighty, He's great, and He's worthy to be praised. Will you pray with me very briefly, Father, in Jesus' name, how we love you and thank you for all of your manifold blessings that you have showered and bestowed upon us as your children. Thank you, Lord, that as your children, we are apt to mature ourselves to become not just children, but mature children of the child of God, that we may become doers, not just hearers of your word. So bless us tonight, God, as we dine from your rich word. Pray, God, that you would give us clarity and understanding. And Father, if you do these things, prevail so careful to give your name praise. The glory and the honor shall be all thine. We ask all this in the name of Jesus. Son of God, we pray. Thank God. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you. Welcome tonight, those of you that are sitting in the sanctuary, using our social distance recommendation. And then those of you that are listening to us by various technology, our Facebook Live, I do believe we have YouTube, Instagram, so many things we have going on. And those of you that are listening by phone, I want to thank those who have the team that makes this happen for us. I want to thank them so very much for making this happen and being a part so much of our technology I'm not aware of. Amen. So I depend on those that know. Amen. And so if you see me put something on technology, it's either here at the church. And if it's not something I did at the church, and if it looks like it's something I did at home, again, you tell the first thing of all, thank you. I'm not a tech at all. Amen. I know how to do three things to the phone. Turn it on, turn it off, and answer. Amen. Amen. Oh, I can make a call. Amen. So we want to thank that team and those who make this possible. Thank you to our ministry, Minister of Music. Amen. And to our brother Bryce, all of you who just made this live opportunity available. Listen, if you're on Facebook right now, Instagram, or even if you're on the phone, I need you to respond to me tonight. Amen. So if you're watching this on Facebook right now and you're ready for a word, just type in the word ready. Amen. If you're sitting here tonight and you're looking at Facebook, type in the word ready. Amen. Type in the word ready. Amen. And once I at least get three reds, amen, from Minister Taylor, once I get three reds and he gives me a thumb up, we're going to get started. So I at least need to know three of you are watching me by telling me. That you are ready. Amen. I got three here. Minister Taylor. Amen. Amen. That's Taylor says, I'm ready. Amen. Now listen, if you don't do it, can somebody say to a night, say, we ready?
Ready.
All right. Minister said three. So there's a minimum at least three of y'all. One for the Father, one for the Son, and one for the Holy Ghost. You're ready for the word on tonight. Tonight, again, because we're unable to come together on Sunday morning at 8:30 hour for our morning Bible study, Sunday morning Bible study, which is our Sunday school, we have taken this opportunity to share with you our Bible study. That's our Sunday school lesson for our Bible study hour. And the good thing about this, the majority of you have Sunday school material, your book you can look online, so you literally can follow us as we do our best to right behind the word of truth for spiritual growth. So tonight, let me begin by saying to you that we are on the second quarter where we are talking something about the promises of a just kingdom. And as we live now in the time that we're living in right now, as many of us are watching the news and seeing what's going on in our government and other nations, we have to admit, amen, that we're living in a time where just is not being 100% practiced, because if it was practiced 100%, then the Lord will take us in a better route to get our attention than he has. Amen. So then we get to this the second quarter where we talk about the justice of God. And last week we talked about how the Lord removes the unjust. And tonight we want to talk about a just loving God. Amen. Listen to these two words, just loving God. Amen. Me and my wife are listening to a book, and one of the things this man does, by a book written by Tony Gaskin Jr., he always does this contrast between what's good and what's evil, or what the right way and the wrong way. And at the end of the book, he always talks about the challenges in life is when you're trying to put both of them together. Amen, somebody. And so the book is supposed to help you put some things together. So when you look at this topic tonight, where it says just and loving, we have to admit we're living in a time now that we wish people do just one or the other. And then when you try to take both of them and put it together, you are going to be just and loving. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. You got some people you wish were loving and not just. You wish they had some people who were just, not loving. But the God that we serve proves to us that He is an awesome God, because He's able to do both. He's able to be just and loving at the same time. Amen. Yeah. I said just and loving. And God knows it's a little, God knew that we would be growing in the faith for doing this, because even in His writing, the New Testament, He told us that a man could be angry but sin not. Amen, somebody. Be angry but sin not. Now, I can't see your face out there live on Facebook. I can't see your face on this phone. But all 14 of y'all like to see your face. Let's tell the truth. Sometimes that's challenging. Amen. Sometimes that's challenging. Amen. To do both. And then, y'all ready for this one? Me and her were walking the other day, Lisa, and this is one of the book two, and we both started this. Stop on the side road and repent. Y'all know the one about forgive and forget. And most of us will what? You'll get one or the other. You're gonna get one or the other. I'm gonna forgive you. Amen. And forgive you. But I forget. But I, you know, we do one or the other. But the good thing about this lesson is God is a God that can do both. Amen, somebody. He's a God that can do both. And the good thing about it, He's doing it to a group of people that really deserves both of them. They really deserve justice or wrath, and they deserve God really not to look at them with any tender mercy or love. All right. Amen, somebody. But because who He is, He's just and He's loving. Now, also look at your text. It says just, and then there's a hyphen there, loving. It's not just and loving, it's just loving. Now, I'm not the best educator. We have a room full of them in here tonight. But what I do know about this hyphen is it brings it together. It's a part of. It's not and. It's in other words, the just of God towards your life is the love of God for your life. The love of God for your life is the just for your life. In other words, it cannot be split. If God gives you just, if God gives you love, amen, it works together. It's all in one. So when we look at this chapter on tonight, we're looking at Isaiah chapter 61, verses 8 through 11, and then we're looking at Isaiah chapter 62, verses 2 through 4. Let's come up to you. Let's get ourselves to chapter 61, verse number 8. Let's get there first. God called Isaiah, who is the prophet this time, to prophesy to the Israelites to draw back to God. Amen. Let's not forget now, this is not the first time that the prophet has spoken to Israel. This is not the first time that God has, they have had God's attention. And the thing about it is God has always spoken to them for their good and for their bad. Amen, somebody. And that's how you know when the Word of God is a part of your life. The Word of God just won't make you happy all the time. Every now and then, the Word of God ought to correct you and warn you. And as the old saints say, every now and then, the Word of God ought to make you say, ouch. If the Word of God always make you shout, holler, jump, and stuff like that, you were in trouble. Amen. But every now and then, the Word of God ought to make you look back, go back and evaluate yourself, and pull yourself together and say, Lord, I'm sorry. Lord, I repent. We do it every first Sunday. Every first Sunday, when we get ready to take communion, we read the letter from the Apostle Paul to the Church of Corinth. And after Paul says this, Paul says you came here and take communion, and you take it out of context. You're supposed to do this in remembrance of me, and you hold these little mini family reunions. Okay, you need these miniature cookouts. And so Paul said, that's not what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to do this in remembrance of the Lord. And so what Paul does in the letter, he also says this. At last verse, he says, examine yourself and then take of this cup, take of this this blood, and not this body of blood. In other words, the Bible is always has always been intended for us to examine ourselves. The prophet of God, anytime he spoke to the people of God, was always to either warn them to examine themselves or to remind them that they would not be in this predicament long, that God would give them victory. One of the two, he brought them back into remembrance. And being at the time, at these times, that the prophet was the mouthpiece and the word of God, so is the Holy Bible now. It is the written word of God. For this is written, infallible, holy word of God. When you open your Bible and you read God's word, you're actually listening to the voice of God speak to your spirit. Somebody say amen. It's speaking to your spirit. That's why the Bible tells us to study to show ourselves approved. That's why the Bible also says to search the scriptures, for in them you think you have life. Because what the word of God has the tendency to do is to show you that you ain't got there yet. All right. Amen, somebody. Some people think they done arrived there. They done been in church so long that they really think they up the way and they actually in the way. Amen, somebody. So when you study God's word, getting God's word, and that's what the prophet was doing. The prophet was always on a mission to remind the people of the consequences of their sins or the victory that was ahead of them. Yeah. Again, look at the topic. And just loving God.
Yeah.
Amen. One thing about it, I also like this, when God brings justice, because he loves you. Anytime God corrects you, it's because he loves you. And let me share with somebody in here. If you've ever fallen, in which we all have, into your sins and your trespasses, and God got a way of exposing you, of lifting you, or reminding you, don't you put your head down in the sand like no ostrich. Don't you let people get on your nerves. Don't you let people talk about you, bother you. Thank God that he loved you enough that he took you, he exposed you, he reminded you, and you did not die in your sins. So many people are dying in their sins because they won't take God's word at face value and correct themselves.
Yes, sir.
And then, can I be honest with the church? A lot of times we don't let people do it anyway.
Yeah.
Let a man repent, let a woman repent, and let love and justice manifest itself in the body of Christ.
Yeah.
Jerusalem flourished physically. Beautiful city, beautiful time, great things going on. But spiritually, they were dead. Spiritually, they were wicked. We're going to get into scripture when we talk about the burnt offering. They weren't doing it in a spirit of worship. No, they were doing it in the spirit of idolatry, doing it in the spirit which was wrong. Okay? So what happens, God comes at this time in chapter 62, actually starts in 61. He actually starts in chapter 60. He comes back to remind them after 7 years of being exiled that God hasn't forgotten about you. Somebody needs to hear me tonight, whether you're in the sanctuary or you're listening to us by outside the sanctuary. Listen, God hasn't forgotten about you.
Yes.
Those of us that are going through this pandemic and people are dying and it seems like the numbers go up one place, go down one place, like one state is going down, then one state is going up, and it seems like they don't know which way to go. Let me tell you something, child of God. God has not forgotten about you.
Yes.
Amen, somebody. He hasn't forgotten about you. And so is it with the children of Israel. They put themselves in this predicament. God allows the enemy of the Assyrians and the Babylonians to take over. And they take them into exile. They make them slaves. They take their lives, and they just disbanded from the rich flourishment of having God on their side. So here they are, they're in exile. Both Israel and Judah are sitting here in exile. And it seems like after all these years, generations have died. People have died. And it seems like like now there's no hope. It seems like there now there's nowhere to go. And so after all this time, God says to remind you, I have not forgotten about you. Watch this, y'all. I am not only going to release you, or I'm not only going to save you, but I'm literally going to restore you. Don't miss this tonight. He's going to restore them tonight. We had a conversation this week, and I listened to the prayer talk, and that's why I have a little difference in it, because we don't like to restore people. God was willing to take these people that did wrong in the same place they did wrong. God was getting ready to send them back to the same place, restore them, and flourish them again. Amen, somebody. That's the love of my God. He's loving and he's just. When God puts love on you and just on you, God don't put it halfway. As we go through this pandemic and as our country is getting ready to open back up, they call it open it back up in stages. Okay? They got this thing called stages. They're going to allow so many things to go, and then they're going to watch the data. They're going to do this. Amen. We thank God for our government. We pray for our government. But God is not our government. The government is upon him. He holds and carries the government. Amen, somebody. And so when God said, I don't have to bring you back in stages. Amen. Yeah. Usually when people come back after being exiled and doing sin, we got this order of marriage stages. They got to prove themselves. We got to watch them. And then we tell them, better watch them. Better watch them. That ain't what God does. God said that when you repent, with a sincere heart, I will restore you. But what I love about the text, not only will I restore you, you will flourish. Yeah. Amen, somebody. Yeah. I hear the Bible. Hey, the Bible. The Bible says, man can't prosper in his iniquities. In other words, when you repent of your sins, stop worrying about people, get that thing right with God, because your prosperity don't come from man. For every good and perfect gift comes from God. It doesn't come from man. So if you get it right with God, and God being just and loving, when God restores you, he flourishes you. So here it is. They get out of 7 years, he brings them back, prosperity, happiness, and all he asks for is genuine worship. God ultimate desire is this kind of relationship with every believer and every man, woman, boy, and girl. He wants this type of relationship. And these were his chosen people. God is a lover of just and desires that all should be saved. And just like God loved Israel, even after their time of sin and exilement, God loves you, and God wants to restore you as well. So what does God do? What happens here in chapter 61 and chapter 62 of Isaiah? Well, the first thing our Sunday school lesson talks about is the promised renewal of God's people. The promised renewal of God's people. Let me stop there for a while and let me share the scripture. Notice the subtopic by itself is a statement by itself. It says the promise renewal of God's people. That right there is a statement all by itself, because first of all, it talks about God already has something out there that he can't take back. Oh, you listen, 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 listen. Somebody need to shout, and somebody ought to type shout on that cell phone right quick. Right now, listen, because he simply said, before he renews it, what he's already saying is, he already has to give to you. The promised renewal of God's people. Then the next verse talks about is a renewal. In other words, what God is saying is, this problem has already been there. You already experienced it. You was in exile. Now I'm going to renew it. Yes. For the joy of the Lord is my strength. New mercies he gives me every day. Do you not know that we live a life of renewal? Every year, if you have a home, if you got insurance on anything, every year you get this thing, we have to renew. Amen. And usually, don't miss this, usually they renew what you already have. Oh, come on, somebody. I said they renew what you already have. So to renew.
knew the promise means God now took the promise away. My sins may have exiled me from the promise. Lord help me. Lord, listen, if I shout on there, y'all don't y'all turn off. I'll come back. I'll come back with you. Amen. Listen, he's renewing what I already have. I already have the promise of God. Just like salvation. Every man has the right to salvation. But you don't get it until you repent of your sins. The salvation is free to all mankind. And then the next part is, he reminds them, yes sir, of who he's renewing it to. He's not renewing it to anybody. Some talking says, you gotta belong to him. God's, that's apostrophe S, ownership. God's. Aren't you glad that you belong to God? Yes. I mean, be honest with me. Aren't you glad that you belong to God? Yes. And so the promise is new. So what does he do? Well, what happens? Well, in Isaiah chapter 61, verse 8, the lesson talks about how God renews and what is the renewal piece on it. So if you'll follow us, we're looking at the New Living Translation. And you follow, it says, for I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully reward my people for their suffering. Let me share something with you. The problem with the enemy, please understand this, is the enemy does not know how to treat you. Remember, you belong to God. And even though they were in the enemy's hands, the enemy didn't even know how to treat. That, to me, that's what makes the enemy and the devil so dumb. You got it. You think you got victory, but you don't know what to do with it. Yeah. Oh, death, where is your strength? Yeah. Oh, grave, where is your victory? In other words, those things that try to kill, steal, and destroy, you don't even have the authority to work. This is why this should make it happen. You cannot stay in the enemy's hand and longer than God intends for you to. A child of God, it can't do it simply because hear what God says. God says, I will faithfully reward my people for their suffering. Their suffering of their own charge. But even suffering at their own charge, God says, enough is enough. That's still my child. Anybody have parents that believe in punishment? I didn't say time out. Talking about punishment. Amen, somebody. And mom and dad would, and they used tools. They didn't use body hand, body, but they used tools. Amen. I wish I would have learned that earlier, but I knew what was formed against you. But they used tools. Amen. And I remember at times my own wife, mom would beat me, and at the end of the beat, then she would start tearing up. And y'all know, I asked the question, you asked the question, right? What are they crying for? They ain't getting no whooping. Can I tell you what happened? She saw the pain. Even though her child was wrong, she saw the pain. And the pain hurt her, even though the child was wrong. Israel was wrong. But God still loved them enough to know there ain't nobody going to treat my children any kind of way. Oh, bless the name of the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord. That's why you should be renewing your spirit to know that I don't care what the devil is trying to do to you in your life. Keep your hands in God's hand, and when God's time is enough, he'll snatch you out.
God said, listen, I've seen the suffering. Then he said, and make an everlasting covenant with them. I got a promise I got to keep with them. Listen, they only can suffer so long. And some of this mess y'all doing to them, you can't do. Not to my child. Not to my child. Promises of the future was for the blessed church. The promises of God was his mercy and gifts
made to the Jews that when they returned from captivity, it would be extended to them through the grace and the mercies of God. Here it is, the heart of the covenant. This is God's heart behind it. Do you not hear God's heart? I will faithfully reward my people for their suffering and make an everlasting covenant with them. This is the very heart of God speaking. He explains the sacrifice of a burnt offering, which really amount to nothing but robbery in the sight of God. Instead, the Lord is just. He told them, listen, the burnt offerings, the sacrifices, don't mean nothing. It don't amount to a hill of beans. It don't. It's being done wrong because of the suffering of the people. So then it goes on and said, their descendants will be recognized and honored among the nations. Everyone will realize that they are a people the Lord has blessed. Now listen, can I share something rich in here? When I get happy, this covenant brings the preeminence of the blessings of God. Here it is. The everlasting covenant brings blessings and blessings, so that the blessing will be known among the Gentiles and all the nations. In fact, everyone will see. You missed a good place to shout right there. I know this Bible is a good place to say amen right there. In other words, listen, these people are in this place by their own doing. Amen? They did it to them. All right? God has a covenant with them. So God is going to deliver them out of it. And then God is going to favor and flourish them. And what God is saying, people are going to see the same people that was against me. The same people that shouldn't be punished. The same people that sinned against me. They're going to see me as a God, love you, and do just by you. In other words, this is it. The justice, you paid the punishment. You went in exile, you left for 7 years, and I told you when you went into exile, I was coming to get you. So what God is saying is, you see the justice is they paid for the sin. The loving is when I kept my promise and brought them out. Now they're going to prosper. But this is what I love about the text, and everybody will see how great our God is. Can I tell you why somebody ought to shout amen? You are the same one. We all have sinned and come short. We all have done something wrong. We came to Jesus. We repented of our sins. He washed us and cleansed us in his blood. And now look at you now. You got the right to the tree of life. God is blessing you. God is keeping you healthy. God is keeping your family. God is keeping your life. That shows the very promise that God made you when his son died on Calvary. I confess, thou shalt be saved. I'm sure tonight if any of us look to testify, when you hear the sanctuary, or you listen about one of our technology media ministries here, I'm sure tonight you will look at your life, look at me right now, and wonder, yes, Lord, I'm one of them. The Lord should have left me in exile 30 years ago. But he took you out, educated you, gave you a good job, gave you a good business, gave you a good family, gave you good money, gave you good resources. Now you're prospering. You're living in the good will of God. And when you look back over your life, you know good and well it had to be the Lord. Amen? It kind of brings the power of blessing. And then the text, it kind of shifts here. It literally shifts, because then 10 and 11 says, listen, it shifts now from what God is speaking. Listen, now he's speaking what God is saying. I am overwhelmed with joy in the Lord my God. Yeah. I'm overwhelmed. For he has dressed me with the clothing of salvation. Draped me in a robe of righteousness. I am like a bridegroom dressed for his wedding, or a bride with her jewels. In other words, the very promise of God on my life has changed me. Let me help you out. Let me help you out. Those of you that are listening and you're young, little more over age than me, my grandmama said it this way. You look at my hands. My hands look new. You look at my feet. My feet look new. Now, this is to my millennials. We say it like this. Woo, you better be glad I'm saved. Back in the day, God changed you. And what he said, this is the joy that we have of how I look now. Okay? He's dressed me with salvation. He's draped me with this righteousness. This is all due to the very promise of God actually saving me and releasing me from this exile life. The covenant brings salvation and righteousness. The granting of salvation and righteousness to God's people is represented by the picture of clothes of royalty.
Yeah.
In other words, when God's hand is on you, God has promised you. The promise of God on you don't look like anything. Yeah. Can I say that again? The promise of God in your life, you don't look like. You just don't look like. You don't look like just any old thing. You literally look like somebody. Amen, somebody. You literally look like somebody. It is a glorious garment. He talks about a bridegroom decks with himself with his ornaments. The bride adorns herself with fine jewels. You know, you've been to a wedding. You know, put on your best. You put on the bride and the groom. They have on their finest. You know, the ladies, but you gotta have something old. Something new, some bar, some blue. I never understand the bar piece. But you gotta have all that, and you adorn yourself with it.
Yeah.
And then you come down the aisle, and then everybody what? Looking at you. You know, taking their pictures, got their cell phone. And then they actually identify you. I see the blue. I see the new.
Yeah.
I miss the bar that she got. Now I'm glad this do it. It sounds funny, but what I'm saying is the text says earlier, and everybody will see. Y'all missed it right there, man. And everybody will see. I'm going to try it again. And everybody will see. Amen. When God, yes, sir. That's it. When God promise is upon you, that's how you look. And everybody will see. Everybody will see the just loving God's presence on your life.
Yeah.
They see something about you. It's a glorious garment. Then the garments are given in a clothes that talks about cover. In other words, what it talks about how God really just covers you with his promise.
Yeah.
I say it again. He covers you with his promise. Try it again. He covers you with his promise. You that did wrong. You that didn't do everything right. You that needed to repent. You that didn't have anything in order. You that didn't do things that were according to scripture. You. His promise of glory covers you.
Yes.
One of the most interesting things that I love about the prodigal son and a good friend of mine shared one time, and I remember hearing it a long, long time ago, and I still believe it. If you ever get a chance in your own study, look at the prodigal son again. We talk about this prodigal son. We talk about how this prodigal son comes back home. And we talk about this prodigal son leaves basically a pitiful. Mm-hmm. He leaves a place where he is dirty. He's ragged. Yeah. Even if he tried to straighten up a little bit, his journey home meant that he traveled on a dusty road. Which means he was still dirty. In other words, by the time he gets to his father, he's still dirty. Mr. Teller, nowhere in the text do I ever read where he takes a bath.
Uh-huh.
Nowhere in the text do I ever read where he even washes his feet. Only thing I hear his father says is put a rope on him.
Yes, sir.
Y'all missed it. In other words, the father says, what I have to put on you can cover
everything.
Can cover all of your dirt and your messes. And when they saw the son, they didn't see the dirt and the messes. How do you know? Because when the other son looked at him, he didn't see the dirt and the messes. He said, God promise you something, and when God promises on you, can't nobody see anything else but the promises of God. They don't hate your past, they hate your promise. They ain't jealous at your past, they jealous at the promise, because they only can judge you by what they see. The only thing they see is the promise of God. Verse 11 closes this first part again, the promise renewal of God's people. It says, the sovereign of the Lord shows his justice to the nations of the world. Everyone will praise him. Can I help somebody here? When people see the very promise of God on your life, God ought to be praised.
Amen.
I know, Grandpa, I'll give you scripture. Let your light so shine, so that men may see your good works and then glorify, worship. Amen. Give him praise. The sovereign Lord will show his justice. The justice is this. Please don't forget now, there's still justice here. The justice is they did wrong. They paid their punishment. And when it was over, God kept his promise and restored them back to who they were. And now men and women see. That's why I tell people all the time, you better get your life right with God. Stop worrying about people. Get it right with God. Because can't nobody trust you like God. Can't nobody restore you like God. Can't nobody forgive you like God. Can't nobody love you like God. And can't nobody provide the justice that your life deserves like God. The earth brings forth its bud. The righteousness is like a garden in the early spring, with plants springing up everywhere. In other words, God's promise and his righteousness is not when you see it. Help me out, somebody that's mature enough to know he may not come when you want.
Oh, yeah.
But it's always on time. And I like that because it's, look at what it says. It says, when the branch spring up everywhere. Mm-hmm. When God places his promise on you and people see it, it's seen everywhere. You flourish. You prosper everywhere. And can I tell you something? As a child of God, you're supposed to be blessed in the city. You're supposed to be blessed in the fields. You're supposed to be blessed in your going. You're supposed to be blessed in your coming. Everywhere your feet strike, you shall prosper. Okay? The life that God promised us is to be a prosperous, springing forth life. We're supposed to spring. We're supposed to prosper in God's will. And that's what God did in this first part. He renews it. He renews the promise. Now again, what I love about this is, again, this is a renewal of promise. Anybody know that? Anybody know what that means? That means Israel had already experienced this once before. That's good news. And let me stop there. That's good news for somebody that's listening that's not saved. That's good news for somebody that's listening that backslid and left the church and left God. Listen, God is waiting on you. He's waiting on you to renew your policy. Somebody needs to renew the policy tonight. This pandemic ain't just out there to make you scared to come to church and make you scared to go to public. Some of us need to take this pandemic seriously and renew our policy with God. Renew it. You know, we check everything else. We check our wheels, check our insurances. We check to make sure we got enough food. You might want to check your salvation policy. Amen. Yeah. And renew it. And then, for this justice piece, it goes into these few verses in chapter 62. And this topic is the promised vindication of God's people. This is where vindication is, where God frees them. Mm-hmm. Where God sets them free from. He clears them. There's an acquittal. The record has been expunged. There's nothing else. They've been vindicated. And can I have somebody here? That's what I love about the promise of God. Don't miss it. The promise of God vindicates you. Yes, sir. What can wash? The promise vindicates. In other words, God's promise to his people literally vindicated the children of Israel. When we look at the history, which we have time to tonight, you're talking about people that were in sin. You're talking about people that were in a sinful state. You're talking about people that God was actually getting upset with. You're talking about people that God loved so much and just couldn't understand why it would do such a thing. You're talking about people that were that knew that God brought them out of bondage. God, they knew that God is a promise-keeping God. They knew that God would feed them with manna on high. They knew that God would turn things over for them. They knew that God would raise them. They knew that God would lead them by fire and by cloud of day and fire by night. They knew that God would feed them and give them what they needed. They knew what God can do, but yet they still turned it back. But God made a promise. Yes. I hit somebody here. I said, but God made a promise. And when God has made a promise over your life, his promise vindicates, clears you from all unrighteousness. When you repent and get yourself right with God, God doesn't wait on no jury. God don't wait on no Supreme Court. There are no appeals. That's why here at St. Paul Missionary Baptist Church, if you join, we don't go through that eyes and second. Who are we? Who are we to take your membership to an appeal court? No, when you get that thing right with God, and God has vindicated you, it is our job to love you and be just by you. Not worry about the eyes have it. What the eyes don't have? Well, there is a man. What are you supposed to do then? Okay. He vindicates his people. And I love it because it's his promise. Look at what the text says, if you will, in chapter 62. I know it begins at verse 2, but I gotta be in verse 1.
Go ahead.
I gotta be because verse 1 says, because I love thine. Oh, y'all missed it right there. My problem is in my reading. I get stuck in one verse. The only reason I'm moving fast like this, because we on social media, because I can stay all night. It says right there, because I love Zion.
Yeah.
John 3:16, for God so loved the world
that
he gave his only begotten son. And we was talking about this today on this book when it's talking about love. And listen, God loves. You hear me? God loves. It's very obvious that the Syrians and the Babylonians didn't love him because God saw the suffering they were putting on. But God love, he says, but I love Zion, I will not keep still, because my heart yearns for Jerusalem. I cannot remain silent. I will not stop praying for her until her righteousness shines like the dawn and her salvation blazes like a burning torch. And then verse 2 says, the nations will see your righteousness. World leaders will be blinded by your glory. Can I help somebody here? When are we going to blind government? We got the right to do so. And you will be given a new name by the Lord's own mouth. Anybody remember? I know my supplication, but he's saying this right here. I got a new name. Over in Zion. Amen. Amen. And they preach got my name written in the Lamb's book of life. Amen. He can open up the book. We have all kind of ways to talk about we have another name. Amen. But can I tell you something? He changed your name when he saved you. He saved you from a sinner. Amen, somebody. To a servant. Amen. He changed your name. And so here it is. It's the coming of righteousness, God's glory. I will not rest. Isaiah prophesied at the time Jerusalem was still functioning as a city, but spiritually died. They were going through the motions. Going through every day. The Lord assures them that he will not rest until Jerusalem is restored, and Jerusalem represents what he wants it to represent, and that is the place of God.
Yeah.
He won't do it. He won't do it. Jerusalem was to be so special to God that when he regarded to it, he called it the crown of glory. Amen, somebody. Crown of glory. We are also, and that includes the people of God, the Israel. He needed them. And so are we. We too are the jewels of God's glory. You don't believe me? Look at Malachi chapter 3, verse 17. You better change. When you get a chance, Malachi chapter 3, verse 17 says, and they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts. In that day, when I make up my jewels, I will spare them as man spareth his own son that serveth him. In other words, when it's time for God to make it up, he's going to add me. He's going to add you. All of the saints of God are going to become jewels of it. So he tells us we got a new name. The Lord will, verse 3 says, the Lord will hold you in his hand for all to see. A splendid crown in the hand of God. And I will present you faultless. I don't know about you, Lisa, but when that day comes, I want to be in that, in the hand when he gets ready to present. I just want to know that I'm in there when he presents. When he presents God's kingdom, when he presents God's people, I want to be in that, somewhere on that jewel. I don't care if it says I'm a jewel, babe. I should be a jewel. I should be a ruby, but I'll tell you anything for that day. I just want to be presented to the Lord, faultless, with exceeding joy. I want the Lord to be happy with me when he presents me to his dad. I want the Lord to be pleased with me. I want to hear him say, servant, well done. I want to be happy with him. I want to be excited when he presents something to me. Amen. You ever go into a dinner and somebody brings something and they say, well, here's something to put together. I don't know how it's going to taste. I don't know what y'all do, but I keep on going to the next week. If you don't know, if you ain't excited about it, I sure ain't excited about it. Amen. Just like I don't like people that eat their own food. Amen. They cook it, put it on the table, and they just watch you eat. Wait a minute, why you eating this? You know what I'm saying? I'm like Mark Lambert, Palm Beach. All right? Make up your jewels, and I want to be where God can, where because he has. Because of this promise of my life has vindicated me. It has cleared me. Here, this is what he's saying. Because I'm cleared now. Now I actually can become a jewel. Yeah. He has taken off the rough edges. He's polished me. He took all the dirt off me. And now here I am, a jewel for the Lord Jesus to be represented. So never again, verse 4 closes, is never again will you be called a forsaken city or a desolate land? Your new name, hallelujah, your name, the city of God's delight, Hephzephah, the delight of God. That's the light, the delight of God, the city of God's delight, and the bride of God, and the Lord, for the Lord delight in you, delights in you, and will claim you as his bride. The promise of God, the promise of God is renewed to you when you get yourself together. He renews your sins, only stop you from enjoying the promises of God. Your sins only hinder you from enjoying the promises of God. But when you get it right, and you confess your sins, when you get it right, confess your sins. When you get it right with God, all things he does is he gives the partisan out of the file cabinet. He puts it back on the table and he renews it with you. And when the partisan is renewed, that partisan clears you. Oh, bless the name of the Lord. From any other death and danger that sin had for you, it vindicates you. And then the Bible says that everybody shall see. How good, I said, how good the Lord is. Amen. God bless you on tonight. Our lesson again on tonight was a just loving God. I pray that you have gotten something from this, that God is a loving and just God to you. Listen, very quickly before we actually get ready to give and let you go with a close of prayer, is there somebody out there that wants to make a comment? Our executive pastor is monitoring our social media right now. We're going to still be monitoring all our social media. If you put something on there, if you want to make a comment or you ask a question, we'll do that right now. We only got about 2-3 minutes. But if you do it, we will do our best to answer that question. Amen. While our questions are coming in, please type your questions in there and your comments in there. Make sure it's something I can share over the make sure that's something I can share over the airwaves, all right? Amen. Amen. So we get away. Let me know. But while we're doing that, we're getting ready to prepare to give on tonight. Yes, when you come to St. Paul, we do believe in giving. We believe in coming to the Lord's house and bringing the gift. Yes, we do. Amen. We don't beg, but we do give. Amen. Yes. We don't beg, but we do give. Amen. And once again, there are multiple ways of giving. You can give tonight. You can give by credit card. You can call in by Givelify. Go online with me and give Givelify. If you want to call in tonight, you want to do that now. Amen. We have people waiting by the phone right now to receive your contribution, donation of tonight. If you like to have prayer, you also can call. Tell the same operator that while you're calling, if you're not calling to give, but you want somebody to have prayer, we have 2 or 3 lines here. We'll switch you over to line number 2, and somebody will be glad to pray with you. Amen. We'll pray with you. So go ahead and give up tonight if you can. The Lord is blessed for your giving. Deacons, if you're going to receive our gifts here on tonight, what we have here in the house to give on tonight. St. Paul members, we need to hear from you. Yes, I need to hear from you. We're doing our best to keep the church afloat, keep the church alive. Today, St. Paul Ministry fed 11 families. Amen. We work with our executive pastor and his wife with our outreach ministry. 11 families received, 11 families received food today. Amen. Amen. And we want to help them. We want to keep that going. So we need your support, St. Paul members. We need your support. Listen, are there any questions or comments that come in? Executive pastor is looking. Lady Morris looking. Mr. Taylor is looking. So if you can't get on Facebook, you may be a little busy. You can always inbox one of them. Amen. Or inbox them. Lady SMR. Amen. Joseph Jones Jr. And Jeff Taylor. Some of us. Amen. Or you can just call in. You can just call in. Do we have any questions come through? Any comments come through? Anybody see anything on our view? All right, then we're going to let you go. Listen, the Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. Thank you for joining and tuning in tonight to our live Bible study here at the Silent Sanctuary, located at the historic St. Paul Missionary Baptist Church. We love you.